we come across the patient which are not able to sit and stand or walk, then the parents comes to the orthopedic surgeon. Before they visit the pediatrician and pediatric neurologist, they take care of children when there is a reflexes that are not improving. And when they comes to us, we take the what are the goals for us. There is a goals to for the movements disorder. Whatever the he has, it should be is ready to. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Our goal is to improve his locomotor function, whatever he has, and to decrease his disabilities. We take consideration of following factors. One is the what is the age at the presentation, and then what is the clinical pattern of the patient, which type of motor disorder he is having, and we also assess whether this child is able to walk, will be able to walk independently, and we see certain parameters for that, and then we assess and discuss with the parents. When the child comes with little later of the 6-7 year or 8 year, definitely they develop certain structural issues in the bones and the muscles. So we also take care of these structural changes, and sometime the minor disorders, minor movement disorder in the walking or functions, when we have to improve, we do a cosmetic improvement surgery in these children. So it is a multidisciplinary approach. One orthopedic surgeon cannot do everything for him or cannot improve his disability, but a movement disorder specialist, a rehabilitationist, a neurologist, an intellectual personality, and the, if the patient has a speech disorder or hearing disorder and the VN disorder, are also involved. Therefore, we have a multidisciplinary approach. We diagnose cerebral palsy and its presentation mindset and metrics or algorithm, which usually we have in the mind and we should keep in the mind, and we should usually it ranges from the presentation in the cerebral palsy very variable, ranging from the mild neurodeficit to severe involvement. He may have just an acquired or he may have a severe involvement of the total disorder. So we follow a certain order, which we call it the diagnostic matrix, and it is an important pillar in the decision making. This diagnostic matrix basically includes history, gait analysis, physical examination of upper lower limbs, spine, and certain additional tests to reach the definite diagnosis and the definite program of the child or the disability or motor function he has. So this is the diagnostic matrix. We initially see a clinical history in which we go to precise birth history, developmental history, and the presenting history. Following that, we take the gait analysis. There are two type of gait analysis. I do when a child enters in my room. I do the observational gait analysis. And this I will also discuss in detail later. And then there is a videographic gait analysis, which we do in the last. That is called the gait labored. Nowadays, 3D gait analysis. Following all these assessments of the clinical assessment, we score the patient. What are the motor function patient at present having? And with that also, we examine in detail about his contractures, his disabilities, his functional disorders that we call as a detailed functional examination. And then the advanced imaging radiography or MRI, if we need, we do it. Usually, all these things are clinical based. Judgment is clinical based by assessment of the function, motor function, and the examination finding, and particularly the gait analysis. In certain condition, when we feel is the patient has a neuromuscular neuro disorder which is progressive, then we do the MRI and certain other things. Or when sometimes there is a structural changes, then we do the MRI, CT, and the imaging for the spine and the hips, particularly is there any dislocation or etc. So precise history usually include to assess, to know whether this patient has an asphyxia or certain other disorder, to describe, to differentiate between a demyelination syndrome, which may be a progressive, or an hypoxic-ischemic edema. These are the two basic disorders for which we take a precise history, and this will also let you know the basic pathology of the child, and that has an important bearing on the clinical assessment and the treatment. So objective of assessment, our assessment are to identify the problem, to identify the clinical analysis and to plan the effective management. Rudolf Zedkakadi used to say the clinical examination has no substitute, and dedicated repeatable clinical examination is mandatory before you embark having a knife in your hand. Detailed examination must be done. These were my, and then assessment should be tailored according to four areas. One is the presence of infantile reflexes, which usually does not have in our children except in the total body involvement, EBI. But otherwise, when children comes to you, usually have a topographical type. Then you have to assess the movement disorder. And if he's in later age group or in the younger age group, maybe he has a hip dislocation problem. So you also assess for the structural changes. The topographical types are usually monoplegia, hemiplegia, paraplegia, triplegia, diplegia, quadriplegia, and total body involvement. The most effective is the monoplegia followed by hemiplegia, and then is the diplegia. And these disorders are usually created by the insult of the brain, which may be in different areas. And also we assess if there is an ethetoid, or an ataxia, or a mixed, or an hypotonic disorder. Usually these type of cerebral palsies are very less. God has given a severity, then number is also less. So when the most important one is the spastic diplegia, which is 65% of the all cerebral palsies, and it is the mostly manageable property. Spastic are usually dynamic or are the static deformity. And mostly this spastic deformity happens when the cerebellum, top of the cerebellum is involved. There is a contracture, strain, some motorness. And ethetoid is when there is uncontrolled movement in the frontal lobe. And the frontal basal lobe, when it is involved, there is a rigidity of tight muscles. Or when the cerebellum is involved, then it is the ataxia. When the basal ganglia are involved, then it is all the uncontrolled tremors. All these are less in the quantity and the numbers. The more in number is the spasticity, and more important is this is manageable problem, which occurs in the 65% of the patient. And this mostly they give a very good response of the treatment. So this is one of the graph which shows the motor development, motor performance of the spastic diplegic children. And if you carefully see it, this graph shows from zero age to the age of the 7 year, that is the normal child, which progressively improves his posture, gait, and pattern of the walking, and there is no spasticity, nothing. And this is called linear improvement in the gait and the posture. While a cerebral palsy patient is, after 2 years, he will find a little bit improvement. If he have a good improvement after 2 years, he will go far like this. If there is not a good improvement by the 2 years, he may have a slow improvement in the gait and the sitting and the posture up to the 6 years. And mostly we say it is the 7 years. 7 years is the line when there is a little bit linear improvement. After 7 years, there is a plateau. There is no significant improvement. Whatever the improvement you want in cerebral palsy patient, it should be between 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, before the 7 years is called before the school going children. You must accommodate, must correct it so that he have this type of graph and good development of the performance of the motor functions. We also predict whether this child will be able to stand up by the ability of his sitting. If it is said in the Penny said, if he's independently sit by 2 years, he will be able to walk, stand and run easily in the next few years of his development. But if he is not able to sit, nowadays it is said if he is not able to sit, he is able to sit at the age of up to the 4 years, he has a 50% chance to grow. This is the child where we need to improve his all minor deficiencies before this 4 years so that he can have a good more than 50% chance to walk. And if he is not able to sit by 4 years, he may not stand and walk. Then here is the child which we need to control his spasticities, his structural changes to develop. And this is the areas which we usually cover in these children. So clinical examination, we now come in the phase three of this lecture. There is no recognized sequence for the examination. And it should be modified according to the motor development. But I usually follow this sequence. So when a patient enters to you, I always look at his posture, what is happening. And then I asked him for the gate and certain gates like Trendelenburg and the address, the tutors. Following that, I asked them to lie on the couch. When he goes to the couch, we assess whether he, what is the problem he's to getting over the stretcher or over the couch. And then following that is the spine examination and upper limb examination in the lastly week. You will see. So I follow this pattern in the examinations, and there is a posture, and that is called, there are two type of posture. One is sitting and then is sitting. What type of sitting is, whether it is supportive or unsupportive. And if it is standing, which type of standing gait he has or posture. One may be the crouch gait, which is flexed hip knee and the hip joints and the ankle joints are also flexed in the crouch gait. There is the jump gait, where the child has an equinus gait. He may have an extended knee or flexed knee. Usually the jump is called when there is a flexed knee, flexed hip and flexed ankles, equinus ankle. That is called the jump gait. And where you, when you find a jump gait, you must examine for the scissor. If he has a scissor, there is the involvement of the gracilis muscle, and that has to be taken care of when you are planning the treatment. In some cases, particularly, I have seen this stiff knee gait. Here, the lumbar spine is extended, and knee are extended. And knee extended, ankle extended. Only if the spine is flexed, that is called the stiff knee gait, which is usually because of the quadriceps contraction. Then you have to assess for the upper limbs. Upper limbs, most important is you have to look for the release phenomena, stereognosis, range of motion. Is there any fixed deformity? The muscle power assessment. And you must also examine the grasp phenomena, whether he is able to grasp and then release, and the fine movement of the thumb and fingers. You have to check for that all as well. It is very important to assess. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. The next stage is the lower limb. This is the most important assessment, because if a child is not able to walk or he can walk, then we assess multiple things, which already we will discuss as per the sequence. One is the contractures. So we have to see whether the contracture is dynamic or fixed. Dynamic contractures are usually easy to manage. And the fixed contractures, we have to further assess why it is fixity, maybe a structural changes, maybe muscle contracture are fixed. Then we also assess the range of motion, power of the muscle either on the one joint and other joint, as well as we generally examine our patients. Then here, these are the certain types. Then as per the age, usually these children, they may become sometime a worsening condition. This cerebral palsy is basically an static disorder, but sometimes you find they develop, initially they were standing very right, but at the 13, 18 years age, they started walking, having a crutches. It means this is not because of the progression, but it is because of the age growth spurt period and the weight he has gained. And you have to take in care of this. You have to advise accordingly. Your child is getting bulky. You must have, he was an equinus, now he's developing. It's because of his weight and the growth spurt period, which you have to be. दूसरों लोगों को थोड़ा म्यूट करना चाहिए. सो गेट पैटर्न ऑब्जर्व्ड इन सेरेब्रल पाल्सी मोस्टली एंड द टोपोग्राफिकल टाइप ऑफ इन्वॉल्वमेंट. And they are best seen when there is a unilateral involvement instead of the bilateral involvement. When you compare a hemiplegia with a diplegic patient, you basically understand what type of gait the patient is. Then there is spastic gait, and these spastic gait are, there are four patterns are spastic gait. One is simple hemiplegia. In hemiplegia, that is the foot drop, only equinus deformity. Then type two gait, that is called true equinus with or recurvatum deformity. And here is the simple equinus gait here, and on the AP and lateral both side, but there is an extended knee and extended hip joint, little bit flexion at the hip joints. So if sometimes in the post-operative, as I told you initially, if you do the TAL, he may develop like a step gait pattern, either flex hip, extended knee, and the normal ankle joint, that is called the stiff knee gait. We will come later on this. Then type 3 is the stiff knee gait. In stiff knee gait, it is because of the quadriceps contractures. So here you find a normal equinus and flex hip or without flexion of the hip joint. That may be a compensatory. Hip flexion may be a compensatory. Then type 4 gait is the jump and is very important gait. And if the patient is a scissor, first, if he is no scissor, the jump simple is very easy to manage. And if you see, this is flexion of the hip joint, flexion of the knee joint, and significant equinus as you, when you go for the swimming, you at least you do the jump. Those who are the horse, they can finally, you will see here also, then you will realize what is the jump gait. Then there is a spastic diplegia. This also has a four type of gait. One is the true equinus, then jump, then apparent equinus, and the crouch gait. I will describe little this in next slide. So here is the group one true equinus gear. Here is the normal or extended hip joint. Knee is also extended, but there is a equinus contracture which is more than plantigrade, more than 90 degree, 130, 110 degree, or minus 90 degree. It is simple equinus. So this is the true equinus gauge. And if there is a further decompensation, then it develops a jump gear. Here you will find a flex knee, flexible. Maybe if extended hip as well, but mostly it is the flex hip. Before jump, you adopt this posture. And then there is an equinus. The others. And then there is an equinus, which more is the minus 30 degree equinus. Further is the apparent equinus, we usually call it a dynamic equinus gait. Here it is same as in a jump gait, but is 90 degree, but when he runs, then he develops the equinus. But when he stand easy with 90 degree, with little bit of flexion and sometimes no flexion at the knee joint. And then is very worst type of gait, which may be postoperative, which may be because of the decompensation of the growth spurt or because of the weight he is gaining. Here it is the same as the extended knee or extended hip or flex hip. Flexed knee and dorsiflex ankle. Initially, in equinus gait, what they develop a rocker bottom foot. There is a contracture of the ankle joint, but they develop a rocker bottom foot like this because of the decompensation of the weight. But if you carefully examine, they have the equinus deformity, and later, with further disability or further weight putting, the triceps become weak, or sometimes we do the TAL. And then goes to develop the four dorsiflexion, which is called crouch gait, and it is the gait which is difficult to be managed. So here is certain example of the true equinus gait. Here you find little flexion at the hip, extended knee, and the plantar flexed ankle joint. That is called the equinus gait. And if you find a diplegia jump gait, you will find here like this: flex hip little bit, flex knee, and the plantar flex or the equinus ankle. This is exactly a gait before you jump for that. And crouch gait sometimes is like that. Okay, when you something is falling from up stand and you are going to catch this, then you dorsiflex your ankle. That is called the crouch gait. So here is the crouch gait. This is the position of the crouch. And if you do your head level, you will feel that this crouch gait is just to crouch. You to some to grasp something while it is falling. That is called the crouch gait. Here there is a bilateral flexion of the hip joint, knees also played, and ankle is dorsiflexed. And this is the worst case to manage. So here is the apparent equinus. Here, when the child stands, he can stand easily with the dorsiflexed, normal 90 degree ankle. Here is the 90 degree ankle. But when he starts walking or running, then he develops a dynamic type of equinus. Then apparent equinus. Okay. So now, after this tamhid or the preamble or the gait patterns, we go to definitive clinical examination, what we have to do. And you know most of these examination methodology while doing the other patient's examination, but little bit variation. And in the past year, there is a little bit of spasticity, rigidity in motor problems, then you have says go. So hip abduction test is the assess abduction of the hip joint, right? And you usually, it should be done in extension. When you do in extension, there is a contracture of, combined contracture of here is the 45 degree. Now you have to differentiate between this contracture, whether this contracture is because of this gracilis muscle or because of the adductor muscle. And this can only be done when you neutralize the gracilis. And gracilis can be neutralized while you are flexing. So in this extended position, when you flex the hip joint, the contracture from the 45 degree input to the 70 degree, it means there was a contracture in the gracilis which did not allow further movement. But if this further flexion, if allows 100% extension of the abduction, it means that it was because of the gracilis contracture which was. But if it does not improve in any way, then it is an abductor contracture. And this must be assessed because sometimes the adduction is so worse that it continues to have an internal rotation as well. So this test is called usually the FELP test. Well, assessing for the gracilis. If you extend, you find 45 degree contracture. When you flex and abduct, it is normal. It means this contracture disappears because of the flexion of the hip and flexion of the particularly knee joints. So if this muscle was crossing over the knee joints, so it was in contracture, it allows flexion, allows the abduction when there is a flexion of the knee joints, which is the positive FELP test, the gracilis contracture. So here, next test is same lying position. We go to the assessment of the popliteal angle. Mind it, in the first 3 years, there is a 0 to 16 degree pop angle positive. Above 4 years, there is a 17 degree usually positive. But over the 5 years, it should not, there should not be any there. And if there is more than 50 degree contracture, then we call it a abnormal. And this this pop angle has to be measured from the 0 degree. 0 is this one, 180 degree. And when you go there like this to the 90 degree, and there is no further flexion of this like this 70 degree, we call it the 70 degree or 50 degree. But if it is 90 degree, then it is 90 degree. And 90 degree contracture is the first contracture which we have needs to be taken down by the various methods. So here is this angle test at 0 degree. We flex the hip joint by flexing the 90 degree of the hip joint. It is not an extension, but in the flexion of the hip joint, when you flex the hip joint 90 degree, it means you keep these hamstring and stretch. This pop angle about the pop angle about the stretches of the hip joint. When you flex it, there is already the tight hamstring because of the neutralization of the other muscles. Here it is a 90 degree. So it becomes straight. Then it, you keep 90 degree, it becomes straight. So now initially you flex it and then you extend. To which degree it goes in extension? In this case, it goes to 650 degree. It means there is a little bit contracture, but this contracture usually not produce any significant problem. But if it is not extended above the 90 degree, above the 90 degree, then there is the contracture. So this is the pop angle which has to be measured. And you also need to compare on both sides, whether there is any difference in between two. Between difference between the right and left, that is called the hamstring shift test. Next is the Sylvia Cole test, and you know how to do the Sylvia Cole test. In extended knee, you flex the, you dorsiflex the ankle joint, and next is you flex the knee joint. When you flex the knee joint, this produces gradually flexing. It produces, if it goes to the dorsiflexion, it means it is a
excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, then good. So this is the Sylvia Cole test, which gives you assessment for the for whether there is a gastrocnemius contracture which arises from the above the knee joint from the femur to the ankle, or it is from the soleus which arises from the tibia and the fibula to the ankle joint. So it will differentiate between the contracture of the gastrosoleus. If it is goes to the above 90 degree, it means with the flexion of the knee joint, it means the contracture was because of the shortness or spasticity of the gastrocnemius. But if it is not go, it remains down, then it is the positive like this inflection, then it is the contracture of the gastrocnemius. But there can be contracture of both. Then in any position, it will not go above the plantigrade or above minus 30, 15 degree. then we call as the static contracture of the both muscles. In this condition, the treatment is different. If it is a gastrocnemius contracture, we do the only gastrocnemius fasciotomy, which is called the valvulotomy surgery. And if it is the both contracture, then we will do TAL. So here is the test, which is called Thomaston, and you are very well versed about the thermal stress. There are certain prerequisites for the Thomas test. If there is a knee contracture, it should be done a modified knee here. It is not a good, there is a fallacy with here because there is a contracture. It does not tell you proper contracture at knee joint. So you do, again on other side, so you do the modified Thomas test. And here is again, this is the modified Thomas test. Same patient, you are finding here is the 30 degree contracture of the flexionary region, but when you have neutralized this knee, or you have the kept on the side of the table, it means that knee contracture, which was, you have neutralized that, you have not doing that. So only pure contracture here is less just than a 5 degree instead of 30 degree. So you must do the Thomas modified test as well. Here is the another test, which is more specific for the cerebral palsy. That is called Stiles flexion hip test. It is the on the prone position as the you do in the supine, but here you do in the prone contracture. It will let you know the which is the what about the true contracture of the hip joint. It is more specific than the modified Thomas test like this. This is the modified Thomas test, and this is the Stiles test. It is more specific, tell you the contracture. Then there is a contracture of the quadriceps, and this test has to be done prone. And prone test, as the patient is lying here, you are flexing the knee joint. When you are flexing the knee joint, the quadriceps muscle, which arise from knee joint, the above to the sciatic tuberosities, these are the spines. So when it is contracture, definitely when you flex the knee joint, there is a shortness again, and his hip is raised. When this hip is raised, it means there was a contracture of the quadriceps here. And it has a significance in the management of the stiff knee gait and sometime in the... So then additional tests you have to, after this you have to do. One test here is the, Trendelenburg test. Cerebral palsy, Trendelenburg test usually cannot be done because of the spasticity. But it has to be done, and when you find there is a dislocation of the hip joint, then you will find there is a positive cerebral palsy. Because of this instability in the gait, he may not stand on the one side in his spasticity. Therefore, we usually don't do this Trendelenburg. And now the foot propagation angle, this is clinical test again, draw a line in which you will find which type of angle he is doing, whether he is doing scissor or not. And this is usually recorded. Powder, zameen, you sprinkle the powder on the floor and then you do the test, you will easily find. Then another test is the rotational tests, are when there is a femoral rotations, femoral antiversion particularly has to be tested by the Craig test, or like this test and the prone lying position, you do the internal rotation and external rotation. You are well versed about this, and the whatever the contracture from 90 degree, that you will call the increased antiversion or decreased antiversion. Then the tibial torsion is examined usually by the foot and the thigh angle. Foot and thigh angle will tell you mostly the external tibial torsions and occurs in the cerebral palsy because of the internal torsion at the hip, then external torsion and the tibia. It may be an internal torsion as well. So it is basically assessed by this. This is, you find here, there is a great difference in both these, the angles of the tibia. That is called the tibial torsion at foot thigh angle. And here is the Craig test. Craig test, again, a clinically test. In the same, like you do internal and external rotation, you do the external rotation when you find a maximum point of the greater trochanter here, and then assess this angle from here. So whatever this is, 35 degrees increase or 45 degrees, that is called the internal tibial femoral antiversion test. Then this is the again tibial torsion of foot thigh angle. You mark, give the marking here and here clinically by your eyes, real balls, are sometimes erasable markers. You can do foot thigh angle, which let you know. After that, there are certain clinical tests with appliances you can do it. Usually, we used to do when we were a student, we apply, if there is an equinus contracture with a positive silver scale, we apply a plaster below knee. And we apply the Biruni to see the ankle contracture, which we release later on. We usually do the indoor when patient, we were admitting the patient. We used to give them BK cast. And when he, with this BK cast, we allow them to walk for 3 days. About if he is able to walk normally, then we do the only tackle the contracture of the ankle joint of the gastrosoleus muscle. But sometimes he do the flexion of the knee joint as well. So we apply the above knee cast. When we go with the above knee cast, and then we ask them to walk. If he does not develop in a steppy gait pattern, then we usually do the hamstring release along with the Achilles tendon release. This was the clinical test when there was no Botox. Nowadays, there is a very easily availability of the Botox injection. We inject them pre-surgery. There are two objectives of this Botox injection. Next lecture, we will have a Botox injection. That either it is a treatment, 6 months continuous, we inject in the gastrosoleus and hamstrings. And then we assess for the next 3 to 4 months how the child is improving or he is getting worse. If he is improving with this myoneural blocks, then we assess them. We say this is very good, and we advise them. If there is a time of he's about 5 years, 4 years, then we advise by surgery. If he's less than 3 years or 2 years, then we continue for the Botox. Then there is an examination under NSDI. Usually, when we go to the surgery, we do the clinical examination on table. We have a 1 minute less. And this is now advanced test ke baad, then you have to re-click the same, so we will reconnect. So there are advanced tests. Advanced tests is mostly the two tests, which I usually do the video assisted observational game. When a child enters, I do the form, the make the videos. And the videos on the both side, AP and side, side, ask them to walk. And then I have assess. I usually don't operate in these cases immediately. But give them one or two more. This is again, you find the rocker button. This is the basically a decompensation. We will discuss in the next phase when we will again start this Zoom. So this is the clinically video assisted clinical test. And then there are laboratory tests in which there are multiple appliances that are applied and 3D videos are there. They will let you know what was the posture, what was the gait, what was the schedule changes. So this was the availability of the gait laboratory in Karachi, which we have done once or twice. These are our children. I also done taken my students about 6, 7, 10 years back, but nowadays it is not working. So in the GATE laboratory, you find three things basically, the posture, then pedogram and EMG. The pedogram tells you where are the pressure areas, whether it is the pilonocavovarus, the pilonovalgus, which part of the foot is doing the more pressure area, heel, touching or not touching, and what there is a cavovarus, so where is the pressure here? Then at the same time, it also do the EMG.